Harris, do you want to tell us a little bit about some of your current research, especially bits that you're working on while you've been here or in the last few months?
Sure. So I've been here and I'm thinking about a couple of big projects. One of them is related to copyright law and the other one is related to trademark law. But the talk that I gave here as my McCormick lecture was about trademark law and the registration of marks that we find offensive or immoral, and the question about whether those really should be registered and should be protected by law. So this project is a very exciting one for me because it really does relate to some important current events, particularly in Canada and in the USA, around the registration and protection of trademarks like the Washington Redskins mark or the Cleveland Indians mark. We've seen a lot of activity around these in North America, with people really beginning to object to encountering these marks when they go to sports events or in their entertainment, and people objecting as well to the way that it portrays First Nations peoples and Indigenous peoples in North America. So that's been a really interesting project, and it was something I was very pleased to be able to talk about while I was here.
And what are your plans to take that forward?
So I'm co-authoring this article with a colleague of mine, Vita Amani. She's at Queen's University in Ontario, and she and I both have a real interest in the intersection of intellectual property law and freedom of expression, as well as culture and equality considerations. So we both work at thinking about gender, thinking about race and intellectual property. So the project really is a terrific fit in all of those ways, because we can think together about how these trademarks have an important sort of communicative power that does really affect equality or cause discrimination in our society. So we're working on this together, and the plan is really to have a paper written within the next few months for publication, and then to really begin to work as well with policymakers and think about changes that could be made to the Canadian Trademarks Act in particular, as well as helping with regard to the human rights claims that are being brought in Canada right now.
Okay, and you said that your other work has been around copyright. Do you see common themes along the two in terms of the larger questions or issues that you're tackling?
Sure. So in both regards, the focus of my work has always been on trying to get us away from thinking about intellectual property as being property. I find the intellectual property metaphor really problematic, and so I like the idea of recasting intellectual property as speech, and then thinking about its communicative power, thinking about relationships of communication between speakers and the audience, and thinking as well about the way that intellectual property is part of a broader cultural conversation or a dialogue. And that is very useful in the trademark context for understanding the meaning and the message of a trademark. But it's also very important, of course, for thinking about copyright law, because copyright is fundamentally about expression and about protecting original expression. And so, of course, about silencing some expression as well, expression that's infringing. And so I think once we open it up and we start thinking about freedom of expression, but also relationships of communication and equality, that helps us to understand trademark law and copyright law more effectively. So the other project I'm working on in the copyright field is about fair dealing, which is of course the exception which allows you to make use of a protected work without permission and for free. And what we've seen in Canada of late has been a rapid expansion of the scope of fair dealing. First of all, with some important Supreme Court jurisprudence where they gave it a large and liberal reading, and created the idea as well of a user right, so that the fair dealer has the right to use the work and it's not just a defense to copyright infringement. So that was a really important turning point in the law, and really a first in sort of the Anglo-Canadian scheme, which always has had a very limited approach to understanding fair dealing and is much more inclined to focus on protecting the copyright owner as a property owner. And so I've been looking at the Canadian jurisprudence, but I've also been worrying a little bit about the trajectory of this idea of user rights and what's going to happen, because we're increasingly seeing a backlash in the Canadian context, especially against fair dealings in educational contexts. There's ongoing litigation with York University right now, and one of the copyright collectives, regarding fair dealing guidelines. So that's about when professors can make copies of materials for their students in teaching. And this has really become an important issue. There's a lot happening in the area, and I'm focusing on arguing about user rights, arguing about the importance of educational fair dealing, and how that actually furthers the purposes of the copyright scheme.
And that's been really important even in the last 5 years, looking at copyright more broadly, because similar conversations have happened in India, for instance, with the publishers being taken to court in India, mm-hmm. and that saga. And you're right that in the Anglo-American context, Canada is exceptional in terms of the jurisprudence that came out early and how it's changing. Would you say Europe could learn something from that?
I think so. I think one of the things that's very interesting about looking at Canada is that it has, of course, its foundations in the UK law. It inherited all of its intellectual property statutes from the UK. But by the same token, it's evolved alongside the US, so there are lots of US influences. And of course, with Quebec, there's lots of civil law influences as well. So in some interesting ways, Canada is really kind of a microcosm of the world, and you get to follow and track intellectual property trajectories and think about how they would play out on the world stage. So I do think there's a lot, especially in the area of user rights and exceptions and limitations, that Canada has to teach the world. And I would like to see the UK courts beginning to follow suit. What has happened, I think, in the context of Europe is a more traditional European approach to limits and exceptions, which is to see them as very narrow and, you know, very specific. And so even when there have been new exceptions added to the Act, they're very tailored, they're very limited. And what we have in Canada is a much broader understanding of fair dealing as being the sort of umbrella exception that really puts a limit and constrains what copyright owners can control. And I think that's very important for ensuring that we have a balanced copyright system, not just at the domestic level, but also, of course, across jurisdictions and ultimately at the international level. And I think that really is what we're going to see now, is the development of treaties that focus on creating baselines that protect users and the public.
So, Caris, while we're talking about the limits to property rights, and in this case, copyright, the other way we think of defining and limiting the scope of these rights is how we set infringement and how we mm-hmm. decide what is infringing mm-hmm. and what is okay. And there has been a lot of developments, particularly in the US, mm-hmm. in recent months and last few years, actually, which touch upon, you know, have we defined copyright too broadly mm-hmm. in terms of what is infringing and how much taking is infringing. And I think you're planning to do some work on that?
Yes, that's right. I'm working right now at the early stages of a paper that's looking at substantial similarity in copyright infringement cases. And so that's the doctrine which tells us when something is too similar. So we know if you're making an exact copy of something, it's likely to be caught, it's going to be within the scope of the owner's right. But the question, the difficult question for copyright has always been, what happens when it resembles the thing that is owned, but it's different as well. And so that's where I am really concerned with creating space for downstream users to be able to build on what has gone before, to be inspired by works that are protected, to be able to transform them as part of that sort of dialogue of authorship and engagement that creativity always involves, I think. So I think there's something unsatisfying about just looking at the fair dealing defense or other user rights or limits or exceptions, rather than thinking more critically about what is the appropriate scope of the copyright owner's control in the first place. So I think, you know, in some of these high profile infringement cases we're seeing, I'm thinking of the case involving the Marvin Gaye estate and Blurred Lines, and of course that was found to have been an infringement of the Marvin Gaye classic on the basis that it had many similarities, and it was eventually found to be too similar. But there's a lot of concern about the way that this is going to affect the music industry, that it could create a chill on people who are trying to write music that sort of evokes an era
or that operates within the sort of confines of a genre that is inspired by work that has gone before. So what I want to do in the paper is really say, if a work is transformative in the way that it might look in the US like it should belong within the fair use doctrine, that maybe a better way to say that is to say it's not a copy at all. And so it doesn't actually implicate the rights of the copyright owner, and you don't need a defense because really it's part of, as I say, this cultural exchange, it's building on something, but it's transforming what has gone before in a way that is actually very beneficial and that gives something new to the public.
So Caris, where do you think all this work that you've been doing and that you plan to do is going to go in the next couple of years? Where do you see it heading to?
Right. You know, I think there are lots of new challenges facing intellectual property law all the time. And of course, these challenges are in some ways related to the new technologies, which are changing so fast that the law is always kind of trying to play catch up. So I know, for example, that a lot of the work I've done on concepts of authorship and the nature of creativity, these things are constantly being tested by changes in technology. So people are talking a lot now about artificial intelligence and AI authorship or AI authored works, and where do they fit within the intellectual property scheme? And you know, I think that's a really good example of why it is we need to be thinking about the big picture of copyright. So thinking about the theoretical foundations, thinking about the sort of normative principles and ambitions that are built into intellectual property so that we can answer these questions in a way that's kind of consistent even as the technology changes. So for my own part, I would say authorship is inherently a human endeavor, and intellectual property rights, especially in the copyright area, are established in order to encourage people to engage in something that we see as a worthwhile human endeavor. And so if we don't need incentives and we don't have humans who need to be encouraged through profit, then you have creativity without intellectual property, then you have the public domain at its best, and I think that's a good thing for everybody. So in other words, I don't have this anxiety over AI authored works. I mean, I think there are lots of things for us to worry about in the realm of AI and things to think about regulating, but I think whether they have intellectual property rights is the very least of them.
Yeah, do we need to give them IP rights? And
right.
If so, who are we trying to incentivize?
Exactly.
If we do give them IP
exactly.
rights?
Exactly.
So I suppose one of the things that I'm picking up is that we're going back to almost the purpose of IP.
Yeah.
In the sense of bringing all your research together.
Right.
We're asking some of the bigger questions, and you know, what is it that we want IP rights for?
Mm-hmm.
And we're rethinking it in light of both cultural developments, technological developments, and so on.
Yeah. My PhD dissertation, which became a book with Edward Elgar in 2011, it was called Towards a Relational Theory of Copyright. And at the time, the idea was that I wanted us to begin thinking about authorship in social context, to be thinking about intellectual property rights as rights that structure relationships between people, and then to really be engaging with questions about what are the purposes of our intellectual property system, what are the social values that we want this system to be encouraging, what are the relationships we want it to be constructing, and really therefore having a very purposive understanding of what intellectual property is about, moving away from thinking about just basic rights and individual entitlements and property, and thinking about how we want to construct our information society, how we want to construct our educational institutions, how we want to help and encourage our cultural institutions to thrive. I think we need to keep our eye on this, and the answers to those questions will always be changing. The important thing is to be asking those questions rather than sitting back and thinking, well, people own intellectual property, what can we do?
Well, it's been great chatting with you, Caris. Thanks so much for sharing details about some of your recent work. And it's been great having you at Edinburgh Law School under McCormick Fellowship.
Thank you. It's really been lovely to be here. So I want to thank you for being such generous hosts. And I want to thank Edinburgh Law School for having me during these past weeks. It's got some wonderful work going on here and some terrific people producing great scholarship in the intellectual property field. So it's an exciting place to be. And I'm very grateful for the opportunity.